Thanks for staying up later. We're with Paul McCartney on November 18th at Carnegie Hall. American audiences will get their first live look at Paul McCartney's Liverpool Oratorio. And they tell me that you had some interest in work of this kind, dating back even to the Eleanor Rigby days, that this notion was knocking around in your head.
Yeah, well, you know, in the early days of rock and roll, I first heard the Drifters, Save the Last Dance for Me, and there were these strings on there, you know, this kind of crossover thing starting to happen. So when we got to the Beatles, we kind of wanted to take that idea a little bit further, so we often worked with classical musicians, like on the Eleanor Rigby thing or on Yesterday, it's a string quartet. On Penny Lane, there's like a little classical piccolo trumpet. And it was always good fun working with these guys, you know, it was different from the people we normally worked with, and they're very skillful. So you just kind of say, could you play this very silly high note and hold it a long time? I said, sure. It's just nice to get that kind of an answer, you know. So it was always fascinating. And I eventually got this offer 2 years ago to really go and do, you know, have a ball with these people.
Given who you are, obviously you could have attracted just about anybody, but you made a conscious decision not to go with big names, not to use a Pavarotti, not to use Aretha Franklin, who was suggested from a different direction.
That's right. Aretha was one of our first thoughts, but as we started writing it, it went away from Aretha's kind of thing. The funny thing about the Pavarotti thing was I asked Carl, who I worked with, you know, who were the best people to work with, and I said, who's the best soprano, who's the best tenors? And he told me that the best tenors were Spanish guys, you know, mainly, or Italian or whatever, Pavarotti, you know. And because this is supposed to take place in Liverpool, and whoever it is got to say, and so it was, I was born in Liverpool, we used to laugh at how it would have sounded, you know, with the sort of, and so it was, I thought I was born. You know, it's like, can't do it, there's going to be too much accent there, you know.
Yeah.
So we had to shy away from that. But I did try and use the very best people I could, but I didn't actually know who were the best people in the classical world. So I just said to Carl, he said, how are we going to cast this? I said, well, who are the best people? He said, well, sopranos, probably Kiri, you know. And then we went through it. He said, bass, there's a very good bass. There's a very good guy called Willard White. And we went through it like that till we got to the Spaniards. And then we said, well, we've got to have somebody who hasn't got so much an accent. And then Jerry Hadley was mentioned. And I met Jerry, and he was great. He was like very committed and a great guy, and he sings it great.
So it was that I was born into this world one summer morning, and breaking through this brand new day, I hear the sound of warning.
You're going to use the Harlem Boys Choir, a 180-piece choir in addition to that. This is quite an elaborate production.
It is, yeah. It's a big thing. When we first were asked to do it, we were asked to do something to celebrate 150 years of the orchestra. And so I think you tend to think of something a bit big.
That orchestra being the Liverpool
Philharmonic Orchestra, yeah. They've been going 150 years, got some very old dudes in there. it's wearing well. But, you know, we realized about halfway through, you know, we could have just sort of done a little quick string quartet and sort of, you know, 5 minutes and said, very happy birthday, and sent a cake with it or something, you know. But instead, we bit off this very big slice, you know, a big chunk, which was like 8 movements, the full orchestra. I think, you know, just being given an offer like that, you don't use a bit of the orchestra, you tend to want to use them all, you know. And also, as a performer, I'm very conscious that whenever I go and watch orchestras, I tend to be watching the guy who's got nothing to do. And I sort of think, they should give him something to do. So I was very conscious of that, trying to make all the musicians who are involved have something to do during the evening.
What do you do with the guy with the triangle, then? How can you get him involved?
Use him.
Is he in there?
It's about 2 little dings in there. He's normally the fella who does all the drrr and the other stuff too, you know, he's the percussionist. But yeah, I try to use them all. You know, I thought, well, as a performer, I like to have a good time. I don't like to just sit it out. So I tried to think like that and get inside their heads, try and write something that they'd enjoy doing, you know.
I haven't seen this, but I've heard tapes of it to get a handle on it. There's a character named Shanty who's born in 1942, as you were, and the early portions of it follow him through his school days. Then he meets a woman named Mary. He marries her. They get into conflict inevitably, and she has a near-fatal accident. Child is born, and they reconcile with the child as the catalyst for that reconciliation. To what extent, such an obvious question, but to what extent is this autobiographical?
Well, you told, that's the best time, that's the best way I've ever heard the story told. People say to me, what's it about? You just get that down. That was good. The first three movements are quite autobiographical, because Carl Davis, who I was writing it with, who's a native New Yorker, who's been living in London for the last 20 years, married a Liverpool girl, actually. Carl said to me, he said, tell me about Liverpool, when we were starting it, trying to get an idea of what we would do. So I said, oh, okay, well, I was born in 1942, and the bombs were falling and all of this stuff, and, you know, and he said, that's good.
The arid siren slices through a night in 1942, a couple sheltering in the gloom, know all too well this waiting room.
He said, what happened next? I said, well, I went to school and started describing school. Told him about one of the teachers who was called Miss Inkley. And I was saying, she was quite weird to encounter when we were like 11-year-old kids. She was a Spanish teacher. Now, it was weird enough to suddenly be learning a language when you're just really some scruff from a poor area. You know, suddenly it's very elevated to be learning a language. But she was a very interesting lady, and she had very thick makeup on. And we were told it was because she'd been in the war and she had like scars and stuff. So it was very, for 11-year-olds, it was like, what?
Mystery.
And, you know, very mysterious. And she said, you may call me sir. And we're all going, oh dear, what have we got ourselves into, you know?
Either that or maybe Lola.
Yeah. So, you know, it was quite, and I'm telling Carl all this. He's going, great, Miss Inkley, school. So, you know, the first movement's war, second movement's school. Then I told him a bit about my teenage years, and I said they used to have dances and discos in the weirdest of places. And they actually had one once, like, down in the basement of a church, an old crypt. He said, crypt? Wow, you know. And he started just picking out the kind of dramatic things about what I was saying, the kind of juicy bits. And so we stuck to that. The first movement is war, second is school, third one is called crypt. After that, I suddenly started thinking, wait a minute, this is getting too autobiographical. Maybe we don't need to constrict ourselves. I would be seeing things like Brunhilde and the Valkyrie and all this mystical on the top of a mountain and the thunder. I thought, well, you know, that's quite nice to be able to have the freedom to suddenly pull in, you know, I don't know, you know, some sort of ghosts, for instance, which, you know, just gives it a bit more mysterious thing than the average kind of autobiographical thing. So after the third movement, we just started moving away and just made up a story, which still contains lots of incidents from my life. As you say, the woman nearly loses her baby. Well, with our third daughter, Stella, she was premature, and Linda had a lot of trouble with her. So, you know, I know what that feels like, and the terror. Oh, my God, there's something wrong. You know, and you're in the hospital, and she's in the intensive care unit. Oh, it's frightening, you know, you can imagine, and anybody who knows that. So I use those things, but it's not about me any longer. It's about this couple we've made up now, you know. And arguments and stuff, you know, I used domestic tiffs that I've been through, you know, which everyone has, you know, and they're always about something stupid. It's never about, you know, the real significance of this relationship. It's always about, where's my dinner then? You didn't cook it. Well, I'm not a bloody slave. Who the hell do you think I am? I've got a career. You know, and suddenly you've got a divorce situation just over where his dinner was. So I use these kind of things, you know, to kind of put it in, but it stops being autobiographical after the third.
Is this a departure that is a one-time thing, or is this an indication of a possible direction?
Well, I'd like to do it again. I'd like to do more work with these kind of people, with these kind of instruments and these kind of voices. I don't think it is a one-off thing. You can never tell. You know, I might try and write something else and not be able to do it. It might turn out. But I'd certainly like to do other stuff. The great thing is that it's limitless. You know, somebody in a review said they liked the violin cadenza I think it's called. I'm not very knowledgeable, you know. To me, it's the violin bit, the fiddle bit.
Was Little Richard your strongest early inspiration?
Little Richard and Elvis. Elvis, then I had kind of two voices, till I sort of found my own voice. I was really an Elvis or a Little Richard impersonator. You find that with a lot of people, they start off doing records, you know, young bands, they do Beatle records, or they're the Stones. In fact, I met Lionel Richie, he said, we used to have a garage band, he said, with broom handles, he said, and I was you. You know. So, but for me, Elvis was a very early love, till he went in the army. Then I went off him in a big way. But Little Richard, I still love. I love Richard. It's particularly his early recordings, of course.
Are you doing Little Richard at the end of Hey Jude?
Yeah, you know, I'm doing every black vocalist that ever wailed. You know, I'm doing that thing, you know, screaming up there somewhere. Yeah. But it all started with Little Richard when I heard Tutti Frutti. It was just the wildest record I'd ever heard. And I learned it. And we, at the end of the term in school, we always used to have the last day as a kind of crazy day that let you do anything, you know. And the authority slackens a little in the school I went to. And we were allowed to bring guitars in. So I remember standing on a desk in the history room singing Tutti Frutti with all, it was like out of a film, like out of Grease or something, all the guys, hey, hey, go, man, go. So I loved him. I loved Richard. And of course, we met him in Hamburg. And he's a funny guy. I mean, you know, he's like an actor now, and he's a great character, Richard.
Yeah. Well, I think you put Long Tall Sally, as well as Chuck Berry thing, Roll Over Beethoven. That was on an early Beatles album, like the second or third one, wasn't it?
Yeah, I used to do Long Tall Sally, yeah. It's great.
And so, wasn't Lucille on the bootleg back in the USSR album?
Yeah, I used to do that. Lucille, Long Tall Sally. I used to do a few.
You mentioned Elvis going into the army, and then Vegas wasn't far behind. And for obvious reasons, in the late 50s, early 60s, there was kind of a glass ceiling over a Little Richard or a Chuck Berry because of race. And you got into that, at least in American rock and roll, you got into that period of kind of sanitized people, of Bobby Rydell and Frankie Avalon and people like that. So in addition to their own originality, the Beatles came into this void where people said, give me something, and you guys arrived.
Yeah, it was a timing thing, I think. It really was, yeah. In Europe, you had this student thing. People always think that we started it. But the haircut and all this stuff was happening in Europe anyway. All the students, all the art school kids, you know, were sort of doing this. The actual haircut was from a guy in Hamburg called Jürgen Vollmer, who was a good friend of ours.
Oh, I remember him.
Do you remember? Wait a minute. Jürgen, who is still about. And he had his hair sort of down here. It was more that one. Yeah. Rather than sort of that one. And John and I, we'd hitchhiked over to Paris around about his 21st birthday. He'd got some money off his rich auntie in Scotland, I think. And we went to Paris on the strength of this. And we met Jürgen. We said, could you do your hair like this, you know? Could you do our hair like yours? And so he said, oh, no, you don't want this. You know, you want your rock and roll, please, you know? And we said, no, man, it's great.
No grease.
Yeah, you know, because he liked that. You know, he was into rock as a photographer. He liked the sort of the hoodie look, you know, the greaser look. But we said, no, you know, it's time for a change. We like yours, you know. So we arrived back in England, and of course we didn't quite know how to style it like his does, so I was just went poof, and just stopped there, you know. People said, God, what have you done with your hair, you know? And we hung in there. We said, oh, you know, it's the new fashion, oh, you know. But there were lots of kids that were picking up on that. So we became kind of the spokesman for that generation. And when we came over here, you hadn't really seen anything like it. And what was happening was there were Beatle wigs, if you remember, on sale. Mm-hmm. And what Capitol Records did, they got people like Janet Leigh to be photographed in a Beatle wig. These are like the publicity stunts. This is the level we were stooping to. But it was great, and it was very successful. So this crazy band had been talked about here. I think on the East Coast, we used to have friends who come back from like Boston, and they'd say, I heard somebody talking about you. Really? Oh, wow, you know, it's going to happen. And we said to our manager, we said, look, we're not going to appear in America until we got a number one record. We just instinctively knew we had to come in a power position, because we crept in, we could just be kicked out the back door. And so we knew, we don't know why, but we just made this decision. And the news came when we were in Paris. Telegram from Capitol. Don't want to hold your hand? Number one in the US. We just hit the roof.
It's the real thing, because the hotel manager of the Whittier Hotel and the Muhlenbeck Hotel signs an affidavit certifying that this is the Beatle bedding they slept on, and who slept on what sheet and was belongs to who, Ringo, George, or Paul.
Now, when you get these things cut up into 1 square inch apiece, what are you going to do with them?
Sell them.
What's the funniest thing you remember about the hysteria days? The Ed Sullivan Show, the jumping in the limousines, the people at the airports?
Well, I mean, the trouble with it is, I'm not sure if it's true, because some of these things are like so long ago that you keep the memory. And I ask myself, well, this is one that I remember, but I hope it's true. And it probably is. But I mean, what happened was, we were in Madrid, and we often would just get locked in a hotel, and you go a bit stir crazy, you know, because the fans are out there and you can't really go around and stuff. So we're in this hotel, and we'd had a couple of drinks and stuff, and it was late at night, you know, and we were sort of getting quite funky and, you know, grooving around. We didn't have anything left to do except go to bed that night, so we were all right. We were off duty. And our manager came in and sort of said, Rudolf Nureyev is in the hotel downstairs, and he'd like to meet you. So we're all going, oh, yeah, great. Well, you know, send him up, man. You know, hey, yeah, sure, we'll meet him. But for a joke, because we were all in Spain, we all happened to have our swimming costumes with us, our swimming trunks. What do you call them, Aubrey?
Bathing suits?
Bathing suits. We happened to have
I'm just here to help.
Yeah, we happened to have our bathing suits with us. So when Rudy came in, we all put them over our heads and met him. Hi there, hello, how are you? And I mean, I'm not sure whether that's true or not, but I think we'll have to ask Rudy. And we just sat there, you know, and when he went, of course, we just collapsed on the floor.
Is it true that you ran into Ed Sullivan on the street? And Ed was a little slow on the uptake?
Many, many years later, yeah, I had to sort of, you know, remind him who I was, kind of thing. You know, we did some big viewing figures on your show, Ed. But I think he was quite a bit older by then, you know. I mean, I don't really want to make fun of him. I think he was getting on then, you know, so maybe he wouldn't remember. But he was fun to work with, old Ed. Well, I mean, you know, he's a legend in his own street, isn't he?
It's 23 and a half hours, but staying up later. And as promised, we continue now with Paul McCartney. On the recent world tour, you did about, I think, half and half. Half post-Beatles and half Beatles material. Yeah. What made you finally decide, yeah, I'm going to put a healthy dose of this material into my act?
It was time, really. The reason all of us in the Beatles shied away from Beatles material directly after the breakup was that I think we all thought, we've got to try and prove to ourselves that there's life after the Beatles. You know, because it's not easy to have been Charlie Chaplin and then want to branch out into a serious career. Because, mm-hmm. you know, even he had problems with that. You know, people still preferred the charming little cheeky tramp, you know. And so we all had that problem to try and overcome. So we all shied away from Beatle material as a way of doing it. But time, you know, so much time has gone by. It's now kind of 20 years since we made that decision. And I just thought, when I was thinking about the tour, I just thought, if I was going to his show, you know, imagining myself as an audience member, what would I like to hear him do? And the inevitable songs come in, you know, like, Hey Jude would be good. Well, how about Sergeant Pepper? Well, hey, could he do Yesterday or She's Leaving Home or whatever? So we left quite a few out, but I just thought, yeah, you know, there's enough water gone under the bridge. There's no painful memories now when I sing the songs. The breakup, it was just painful. You're just singing something with so many memories. It's like, I likened it later to kind of like singing the ex-wife songs when you've had a divorce. Yeah. No way, buddy. Ooh, you know, no way. Is she going to catch me doing that one? You know, so, you know, we all made that decision independently to do that. But I say, there was enough time gone by, so I just thought, well, it might be good to do them. So we started rehearsing them. And it was great fun. because I hadn't done them for so long. I'd been keeping, steering clear of them.
Yeah.
Suddenly I was able to kind of think, hey, Jude, after millions of years, I really enjoyed it. Sergeant Pepper, I'd never ever done that. Only on the vocal take.
You see, that's what people forget after the San Francisco concert, I guess around 66, the Beatles are a studio band, and maybe some early rock videos, as we would call them now, through the rearview mirror, but Sgt. Pepper, Hey Jude, Get Back, those have never been performed in concert.
That's right, you know, we never did them, so it's great to rediscover them, because they were actually fresher than my contemporary material, because I'd been doing that. Suddenly there were these kind of songs that are really nice to do. That was the other decision. I mean, if you've got Hey Jude, you can get the crowd going, nah, and it's great, you know, and you've got like, 60,000 people doing that. It's a great thing to do.
What did you find, maybe to your surprise, moved you the most while you performed it on stage?
I think really the only thing that really happened, because most of the time I don't get that moved, because I'm thinking of words. You know, it's like an actor in a very sort of dramatic part. You're really thinking of your next line. You're trying to remember where I walk next. You know, there's a lot of that goes on, even in a music show. So. You don't get that involved, but there was one moment really in Hey Jude, because I hadn't done it for so long. There's one line that always reminded me of John, and that used to get me kind of emotional, you know, when it'd creep up on me and sort of catch me unawares. There was a line, the movement you need is on your shoulder, which when I was playing John the song, I basically sort of wrote that one. On the tour, I kind of do my Beatles songs, you know. So I was playing John this song when I wrote it, and I'm going, you know, Hey Jude, and he's going, yeah, yeah. And I said, the movement you need is on your shoulder. I said, I'll be changing that. You know, it's stupid, you know, it sounds like a parrot. And he said, you won't, you know. He said, it's a bloody great line. I said, no, that's stupid. The movement you need is on your shoulder. What does that mean? He said, I know what it means. He said, that's probably the best line in it, man. So I said, great, you know, and when you've got a collaborator like John, you leave it in, you know, because if he says it's great, it's great. It's like, you know, if I insist on a line in one of his songs, I could persuade him. We can persuade each other, we respect each other's opinion. So when I got to that line occasionally, the movement you need is on your shoulder, you know, and it was quite occasionally a bit emotional to sort of sing that. So let it out, let it in, head to begin. You're waiting for someone to perform with. And don't you know this, just you, and you do. The movement you need is on your shoulder.
You said in a Playboy interview that's probably more than a decade old now, that all of you, and maybe especially you, because you were the primary collaborator, coveted John's approval. Mm. And you were quoted as saying he was the oldest, which is indisputable.
No, it isn't. He wasn't. Ringo was the oldest.
But he was the older of the, I guess, of the two of you.
The older.
The older, right. That's correct. That is correct. Let's get the chain
let's
of progression
get the old
here.
Thing here, you know.
Old, older,
Ringo,
oldest.
Very old. John, senile. Me, ancient, but a little less ancient. No, go ahead.
So anyway, and also quoted as saying that he was the smartest and the quickest wit. Were you being kind, or was that true?
No, I certainly think that was true. I certainly think John was the quickest wit. There was no doubt about that, no contest. That was definitely true. And we did covet his, respect, his attention and stuff. I think, you know, having said that, I wouldn't mind betting he coveted ours. You know, we don't think of that. You never know. I just know what I felt. I don't know what he felt. And John was not very forthcoming about what he felt. He was quite a private person, and you'd only ever see it in tiny little instances, you know, that he, I remember once, one of the things I remember about John was silly little things. you don't remember all the great big moments. They just went by in a flash, you know, meeting the Queen, hi there, whew, gone, you know. But you remember stupid little things. I remember we were kind of arguing once about something musical or something. And I remember John just kind of taking his glasses down and sort of saying, it's only me, and putting them back up again. You know, so maybe he did have similar feelings towards us that we had to him. But he just didn't make it perhaps as obvious. But we were Lennon fans, definitely, you know. He was a great guy.
You were an ex-Beatle by the time you were 29. So this extraordinary rush of worldwide fame and extraordinary experiences that happened to you and John Lennon as very young men. And ever since that time, people, some with knowledge, some without knowledge, have speculated about the nature of that collaboration, the nature of that relationship. What sense are you able to make of it now?
Well, you know, I think in life it's not that easy to analyze your relationships with people. Not just John. I think with anyone, it's not that easy. And as you say, when fame's in there as one of the factors, it can get even more complicated. But I always feel quite lucky having I had a really great family in Liverpool. I had great parents, and I have quite a secure childhood. I never realized it at the time, but talking to someone like John later and hearing about his childhood, when his father left home when he was 3 and things like that, you know, boy, I don't know what I'd have done if that had happened to me. So I think that helped me just to sort things out and to sort relationships out, just my kind of Liverpool upbringing, because they were pretty much feet on the ground people and very earthy people I come from, you know. So if there's any bull going around, it gets found out fairly quickly, you know. So
see how these images take hold. Even sitting here talking to you, a man I hadn't met until half an hour ago, you're accessible, you're open. John seemed to have more of an air of danger, and people equate that with an artistic temperament. Mm. And so the easy compartments happen. Mm. Paul's the melody maker. Mm. John's the artistic soul of the Beatles. And people forget that, yeah, Paul wrote Yesterday, and he wrote The Long and Winding Road, but he also wrote Helter Skelter and Why Don't We Do It in the Road. He wrote Day Tripper. You know, how much does it bother you still that people don't have the full picture?
It doesn't really bother me too much. You know, it's a natural thing that happens there. I was actually just talking to someone before about that. I think the only way I could get the kind of edge John had would be to have a different childhood, and I certainly wouldn't have wished for that. You know, John had a real bad time in his childhood. As I say, you know, his father left home when he was 3. His mother lived with someone down the road. He didn't live with his mother, although he idolized her. He lived with his aunt and uncle. Then the uncle died. John started to think he's got a jinx. Any men he lives with leave rather suddenly. And I think John was a very frightened person about that. His first marriage didn't work out. So he had a lot of pain, you know, inside himself that I didn't have. So, I mean, the only alternative for me is to wish for a painful life, which I'm not going to do. You know, if that's what I require to be a great artist, then I don't want to be a great artist.
Maybe then the best situation is not to have to live the life, but to have him there as a sounding board. To have
well, I
him
think that was what was the great thing.
Have
you know?
Both of you kind
and,
of.
And, you know, you have to remember me as a sounding board for John.
Sure.
You know, because that is the thing I say to people, you know, if John had thought that I was rubbish. He didn't suffer fools, gladly. He wouldn't have worked with me as long as we did. We wouldn't have been able to do what we did if he didn't. We enjoyed it. We sat down. We really enjoyed each other's company. We were really good for each other, too. Because John, as you say, was more the sort of acid wit, the sort of... I mean, I was writing the song, a song off Sergeant Pepper. John, it was always great this way. You know, I was writing the song and he's sitting by the side. He had a guitar, I was on piano. I'm going, it's getting better all the time. And he's going, it couldn't get much worse. And you go, get it down. You know, that's fantastic. You know, and I'd say, I don't care what people think or how they analyze it. I think if John was here now, I don't think he'd say he was the only one in the Beatles or that he was the soul of the Beatles. I think he'd admit that it was a pretty equal affair, really. But, you know, having said that, he was great. And I'm more than proud to have worked with someone like him. It was a great experience, you can imagine.
I've read, and we all hope it's true, that you more or less reconciled before he was shot.
Yeah, that was really the great thing about the whole thing, because I don't think George did. You know, we were often having arguments around about that time. And, you know, business things, and you'd sort of ring up and we'd shout at each other and slam the phone down, you know, and it got pretty difficult. But very luckily, I think, a couple of months before he died, we'd got really some good conversations on the phone. I'd just be ringing him. It was around about the time when he was doing role reversal with Yoko. He was a house husband. Mm-hmm. This is, you know, John did that for a little while. So I remember ringing him and I was saying, you know, what's happening? What are you doing? He said, well, I'm just padding around here in my robe. I've just put the cats out. I'm just going to make some bread. And I've got the washing up to do, love. Oh, dear me, a woman's work is never done. You know, that was great. So I can relate to all that. You know, that's just good old stuff. And it was great to relate to John on that kind of level, which I find very easy. So we really did. We reconciled and we were talking very friendly to each other. As I say, I'm not sure, but I think George may have a slight regret that I don't know whether he did get that conversation in. Listen, I mean, you know, whether he did or not, he knows John loved him. I mean, we you know, for all our craziness, we loved each other. We were real good buddies. But that's the way that good buddies, you know, they occasionally hate each other. It's the way of any great love affair or any family or anything. It's not all...
You don't need me to tell you this, but I guess for the benefit of the audience then to get your reaction. If somebody didn't, mixed in with it all, genuinely love somebody, genuinely care about their feelings about them, they wouldn't go to the lengths, in whatever strange way, that John did to lash back at you. They wouldn't hold a pig on the cover to parody you holding a sheep and ram. They wouldn't, you know, call your stuff rubbish or write how do you sleep. They wouldn't do it.
No, I think that's right. You know, I think that's right. I think he was very hurt. There were people turning him against me. It was his way of defending himself. He was quite pissed off about the McCartney bandwagon, as he once called it. You know, oh, bloody, you know, he's getting on all the telly, he's selling records. You know, he was a jealous guy. You know, but I understood that. That was John. You love it or you leave it. And I stuck with it for many, many years. And I think we would have all continued the Beatles, but Yoko came along, John fell wildly in love with her, he needed a big, big change in his life, and he got it. You know, he came to live in New York, he kind of threw over all his English contacts and everything, and you know, can't blame him. That's what he wants to do in his life. So we had to kind of fade into the background to allow them to have their relationship. What are we going to do, ringing him up, hey, John, you know, hey, come and see me. Leave Yoko. You know, I mean, yeah, that obviously never going to happen. So you had to let him do what he wanted, you know, and he did, you know, and he enjoyed it.
How often did you walk around and a melody or some kind of snippet of a thought went through your head and you said, that's better for John's voice, or this would be good if the two of us could work on it together?
Well, that still happens, obviously, you know. You get an idea which is sort of Lennon-esque, then you can't help thinking, you know, and particularly me who's worked with him so much, you can't help thinking, boy, you know, we could really develop this one. Unfortunately, I now have to just do it my way, as the man said.
Yeah.
You know, which is okay. There's nothing I can do about it. You know, great, sure, if John was here, I'd much prefer to develop them with him, but I don't have that luxury.
Speaking of my way, that segues into the next thing. I think Sinatra once did something, which of course was George Harrison's song.
Mm. He announced it as my favorite Lennon-McCartney song, too. Thanks, Frank.
Okay. Didn't Ella Fitzgerald do All You Need Is Love?
Or she did Can't Buy Me Love.
Can't Buy Me Love, okay. And Otis Redding put Day Tripper into one of his sets. The point I'm getting to is there are probably hundreds of thousands of Beatle covers. Mm. Which ones do you like the best? And which ones do you say, please, no, I'll buy it back from you?
I'm not telling you those ones, because the artists are probably still around. But the ones I love, there's a Roy Redmond version of Good Day Sunshine. It's not really known by many people, but I love that. I like Ray Charles's Eleanor Rigby. I tend to like the black versions, just because I like black vocalists, you know, and I like what they do with the song, and they funk it up a bit, you know. And it's always, plus it's a great honor, you know, for a kid like me who started off totally idolizing a record like What Did I Say by Ray Charles.
Yeah.
To have him do my song, I mean, you know, that's something special. Stevie Wonder, We Can Work It Out. There are some great ones.
Try to see things my way. Do I have to keep on talking till I can go on? Why you see it your way? On the risk of knowing that our love may soon be gone. We can work it out. We can work it out.
She was a thing. Picks up the rice in the church where a wedding has been. Lives in a dream, waits at the window, wearing the face that she keeps in a jar by the door. Who is it for?
Tomorrow night, folks, we conclude with Paul McCartney talking about his solo career. The conversation turns to Michael Jackson a little bit, and there'll be more Beatles stuff. That's tomorrow with Paul McCartney. Until then, see you later.
McCartney, Part 3.
What do you think is the lasting meaning of the Beatles, if there's a meaning to be taken from this?
All You Need Is Love.
Later tonight.
Thanks for staying up later. This is the third of our three programs with Paul McCartney. We hope you caught the first two, because there's no backtracking. We're forging straight ahead. And we pick up the conversation with my question to him about some of the early skepticism in the United States about the Beatles. The record companies, the DJs, they didn't catch on at first. Love Me Do, and I think the flip of Love Me Do was P.S. I Love You. That had been out for 6-7 months, yeah, and just lying around.
She none loves the, you as well.
Yeah, none of the DJs or record executives in the United States, at least, were hip to it early. No. They thought this is going nowhere.
That's right, yeah. And we were worried. We were thinking, oh my God, you know, it was a hit in England, but now there must be something, you got to do something different from America.
Yeah.
But I Want to Hold Your Hand was the one that finally did it, which is funny, actually. I mean, I don't know if it's anything to do with it, but I know when we met Bob Dylan years later, you know the bit in the middle that goes, I can't hide, I can't hide, I can't hide, woo, oh, you. He's saying, oh, man, he said, I thought that was I Get High, I Get High, I Get High. So maybe that was something to do with it. Say, no, Bob, you know, it's I Can't Hide. I don't know, you know, it's, it just caught the imagination, I think, that record. Suddenly then all the others got interested. You know, She Loves You became a hit all over again. They Loves Me Do. We ended up with like the top five at one point.
See, even that early stuff, before you can see the clear departure into more artistic material, before Revolver, before Rubber Soul, when the break becomes very clear, if you look back on that early stuff, it's not just the freshness. There was some clever things done there and different things done there that people didn't recognize because they were concentrating on the fashion, they were concentrating on the hysteria. But even starting a song like She Loves You with the chorus. Think about 1,000 rock and roll records. I can't think of any that start with the chorus like that one did. It's just different.
Come right in with the hook.
I mean, you guys had that. I heard you say to somebody, maybe in a moment of immodesty, you were a little cleverer than everybody else around.
A moment of immodesty, that's right. Now, it is difficult to kind of talk about that without really seeming, you know, big-headed. But we were slightly different. It wasn't so much clever, really. That's kind of the wrong word. It was, we were slightly more artsy. We were a little bit more like an art group. For instance, we did a waltz. There was a James Ray. There was a guy called James Ray. And we had his album, and he had this little song, If You're Gonna Make a Fool of Somebody. Now, nobody was doing waltzes. But we'd just do this. We tried to be different. We'd go for the B-sides of records, lesser-known songs, and our whole repertoire was made up of quite weird songs because of that. So it did make us different. And I think, you know, with me having gone to a grammar school and got a couple of exams and stuff, done reasonably well, with John having gone to an art school, George went to the same school as I did too, and Ringo went to school for 3 days. He was something else.
But he was a quick study.
He was a boy, was he a quick study. That's another story. He was ill a lot when he was a kid. I think it did give us a little bit of a different attitude, you know, a sort of slightly wittier attitude with someone like John. I mean, we were asked for, somebody said, how did the group start? And instead of sort of, you know, saying,
The group started when the boys got together at Wilton Town Hall in 19...
John sort of started a bit. We got a vision on, you know, a man came to us on a bun and we had a vision. You know, it was always like that.
Would you please sing something?
No! Sorry.
Next question.
We can sing.
No, we need money first.
There's a question here.
How many are bald if you have to wear those bits?
To all of us.
I'm bald.
You're bald? Oh, we're all bald.
Don't tell anyone, please.
I'm deaf and dumb, too.
Tell me, how did you find America?
Turn left to Greenland.
Has success changed your life?
Yes.
I'd like to keep Britain tidy.
Are you a mod or a rocker?
No, I'm a mocker.
We developed this little thing in Europe. We developed, because we'd started to get contact with the press, and so we'd started to sort of realize the game here. You know, if you wanted to get invited back, you had to say something, you know. So I say, and John was particularly good, and Ringo was very good at that too. He always had a little answer, you know. He's got a funny guy.
A lot of people would say, if you had to pick one album, Sgt. Pepper's the album. Would that jive with your own assessment, or is that more because it was a cultural impact and wasn't maybe as good musically?
I don't really make any differentiation between the albums. I kind of think for the time and for the musical knowledge we had, each one's got something special. I probably would choose Sgt. Pepper myself, because I had a lot to do with it.
That was your idea, sort of alter ego band, right?
You know, that was my idea, but it wasn't entirely my idea. But yeah, to get us away from being the Beatles, I had this idea that we should pretend we were another group, and it took hold. You know, even down to getting costumes made and everything. I think. Yeah, I'd probably choose that if I had to, but I wouldn't want to, really. I'd prefer to sort of have each one for what they meant at the time. You know, Abbey Road is a nice album. Revolver's a nice album. Rubber Soul's a nice album. So I wouldn't like to choose, really. But if I had to, I'd probably, you know, on a desert island, I'd probably take Sgt. Pepper with me. It stands up. It's still a very crazy album. It still sounds crazy even now, after all these years. And you would think that it would have really dated and that stuff since it would sound so much more modern. But I don't think it does. Some of that stuff really sounds pretty wacky still.
I'll ask you only one question like this because you're probably tired of hearing it in one form or another.
No.
it's pretty obvious that you guys reflected your time and helped to shape it. But what do you think is the lasting meaning of the Beatles, if there's a meaning to be taken from this?
All you need is love. Should I elaborate?
If you'd like.
You know, after the 60s, that was kind of looked on as a bit sort of stupid. You know, hey, all you need is love, dude. You know, well, you need more. You know, we need weapons and we need defense or whatever, you know, which is also true. But it's coming back. It keeps rolling back, this idea that what these people on this planet need is love, you know, and I think that was our message.
All you need is love.
Give peace a chance, John wrote. You know, I always say to people, you know, we could have had a really satanic message, and with the power we had, boy, you know, we could have made quite a difference the other way. But we always chose not to do that. Nobody was remotely interested in that. We had this idea that all you need is love, dude.
In the end,
I still believe it.
In the end, the love you take is equal to the love you make. That's your song.
That kind of thing, you know. I still think that that's true. I think the idea gets knocked every so often because, you know, it's a violent world and that you do need other things. But I still think that's the message.
And in the end, the love you take is equal to the love.
What do you think are the best songs you've done on your own? You know, I went back before I did this interview and listened to some Wing stuff. And some of it people take pot shots at. Mm. And I don't like all of it as well as I like the earlier stuff with the Beatles. Mm. But if I were to pick the 10 or 12 best Wing songs, I certainly wouldn't be ashamed to throw those out on a compilation album.
No, you know, the thing about Wings was that we did everything we did in the shadow of the Beatles' legend. So we never thought we were successful at all with Wings. We always just thought we were you know, never producing anything good, really. But I think, looking back on it, like you're saying, I think Maybe I'm Amazed was a reasonable song and something I would have been quite proud to do in the Beatles.
Maybe I'm afraid of the way I love you.
I think there are a few songs. You know, you can't get it all right. And obviously, faced with an uphill battle, which it was to perform in a group after you're known as the Beatles, you know, I think we did really well, relatively speaking. And in fact, certain albums I always thought were terrible bummers, I'd looked them up in the charts and they were kind of number 8 in America or something, you know. Okay, that's not number 1, but boy, it's not bad, you know. So, I think there are certain few songs there that still hold up.
When will you tour again?
Probably next year.
This must be a great kick for you, because as I understand it, like you said earlier, you wanted to keep on with the Beatles, and not the least of which of the reasons was you wanted to go back and perform, maybe in smaller venues. And, you know, a lot of those Beatles performances after you hit, they weren't really concerts as much as they were cultural events. You probably couldn't even hear yourselves on stage. So now you get a chance to perform again. That has to mean a lot to you.
Yeah, I like performing. You know, I'm some kind of a ham. I don't like just sitting at home twiddling my thumbs, you know, or just being in the studio all the time. There's something about the feedback from a live audience that is very special. You make a record in a closet kind of thing. It gets released. You see it go up the charts if you're lucky, but you don't see the whites of anybody's eyes. You just see figures and you see accountants talking to you about how you did. When you get out on tour, there's people. Hey, I remember you. And, you know, you can see the first 30 rows and you kind of relate to them. Hey, who have we got in tonight? You know, that looks like a nice-looking couple over there. And I enjoy that. I mean, I'm that kind of a person, you know. I like to get out and also, obviously, the applause is something you don't get when you do a record. We can buy me love. I think we're all pretty insecure as humans. I think, you know, we've all got quite a good dollop of insecurity. I figure if I have, then, you know, and I've done so much, I shouldn't be insecure at all. So if I've got it, I figure most people have got it. I think it can help. A bit of applause can help. You sort of think, hey, yeah. You know, it's like, Sally Fields came on the Oscars?
Right,
you love me, you know. It's that one, you know, it's... You hope they'll like you. If you actually do a concert and they applaud and you can see someone, you see a fully grown man crying, you figure, well, he probably liked it.
Right now there's a film about the world tour of a year ago called Get Back. And of course there was a live album made out of various concerts from that tour. But is there a new studio album in the works now?
Yeah, I've just written the new album. We go in a couple of weeks, we'll go in the studio and start working on that with the band, basically the same band that was on the world tour, but with a different drummer.
I didn't realize that you wrote at least the substantial part of When I'm 64 when you were 16.
I wrote the tune then, yeah. That was in the days, it was actually kind of pre-rock and roll. The kids now can't imagine a time when there wasn't rock and roll. But it was just before that, so it was kind of, you know, we were looking to kind of interest people like Sinatra, rather than do rock and roll, you know. So I did this little da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. And then the words came later. But yeah, I wrote the tune when I was quite young.
So now you're closer to age 64 than you were either when you wrote the tune or when the whole thing came together and was
released. Thanks a lot.
Released.
Yeah. Thanks. I love this guy. Yeah, no, that is true. I have to own up to this. Yeah, I'm fast approaching 50 next year. But, you know, hey, we're all getting there one way or another.
Can you see yourself performing? Into your 50s, into your 60s?
I don't know. I didn't think I'd be performing when I was 30. You know, I thought it'd be very unseemly to be jiggling around on a stage at that age, that great age. Now that looks very young, 30. I see people approaching 30 and they say, oh my God, you know, I don't know how I'm going to handle it. And don't worry. It's okay. Yeah, I could be performing when I'm 90, you know, but the songs will be very slow, I think, by then.
I got arms along.
There's an interesting irony in that you own the publishing rights to a whole lot of music, and not all of it is rock and roll. Some of it is Broadway stage shows, and others are ballads from years gone by. But Michael Jackson has the rights now to all the Beatles stuff. How much did it bother you when Revolution was used to sell Nike sneakers and things like that?
Heaps. Yeah, you know, it was... I'll tell you why. You see, with the Beatles, we had all those offers. You know, anybody who publishes songs, you get those offers. Hey, can we use this commercial? We had the offers from the big soft drinks companies. You know who I'm talking about. Big, huge offers to use a Beatles song, to use this and that. But we always turned them down because we believed it'd devalue the whole thing. We'd be seen to be selling out, which we were keen not to do. You know, we kind of felt that our fans believed in us and that we owed them some sort of integrity. We talked to them. We knew what they thought of us, you know. So something like Revolution, you know, it meant more than a pair of sneakers. So, and I think the danger is it does devalue it. And I think even commercially, it's not that great a decision. But anyone who knows music publishing, there's a lot of pressure on you to do that because it's a big heap of cash comes in suddenly and, you know, it's very hard to resist for anyone. But I think we shouldn't do that. I don't really think we should do that. I think it's more sensible to leave the kind of legend intact. And I think they'll do great, the songs. I think they'll continue to do great. And I think to commercialize them like that, I think it spoils them. And having taken that decision with the Beatles, it's now out of our hands, really. We don't have the authority anymore to do that because it's now been sold. But I do still think it's a pity. But I think it's something we might change, I don't know, in the future. But personally, I also think, as I say, it doesn't make commercial sense. I think you weaken, you end up with a weak catalogue of songs that are thought of as sneakers, automobiles, Snickers bars, and stuff, you know.
Here's something I just saw in last week's Rolling Stone with Jerry Garcia on the cover. It's obviously John's glasses. Woke up, got out of bed, dragged a comb across my head, found my way downstairs and drank a cup. John Lennon, Paul McCartney. Maxwell House coffee.
Oh boy, don't you love it? Well, never mind, love. It's not the first time and it probably won't be the last, but there you go, that's what I mean. Cheap and nasty, I reckon. But, you know, I think also the other thing, you see, I'm kind of subverting this whole thing by sort of letting Maxwell House know that the composer of these lyrics, or actually they happen to be mine, doesn't like them being associated with this. And I think in the end, I think they won't like getting involved with a song where someone's not happy about it. You know, they'd rather have something clean and simple. Perhaps, I don't know. That's a hope for the future anyway. Suddenly I see you. Did I tell you I need you? I got to get you into my life. Goes without saying that we're appreciative. It was good to